Tarzan of the Apes, brought to you from out the pages of Edgar Rice Burroughs' amazing book. The jungle dawn flames into another day. Tarzan wakes and stirs. He stands up, raises his arms high above his head. He gazes about him. All around, the waking animals yawn and stretch. Little birds try preliminary flight. Monkeys scamper about in sheer joy at being alive. Off to the edge of the brush, he sees his top snake unwind his sinuous length and glide off into the tall grasses in search of a fat peccary or cheetah cub. Far below and to the left, Tantor the elephant, Tarzan's friend, sedately makes his way along the trail. Tantor is going to bathe himself in the cool waters of the pool. Tarzan reaches up, swings himself off into the upper terrace. Rapidly, he overtakes Tantor. He calls on his friend to wait. Tantor hears, and lifting his trunk, trumpets a greeting to Tarzan. Dropping hand over hand down the familiar vines, Tarzan drops to the broad back of the mammoth beast. Tarzan greets Tantor, seats himself behind the flapping ears, and together they wend their way to the water. At the little hut in the clearing, Professor Porter and his friends have arisen from their slumbers. Breakfast is almost over.
Just drop more coffee, if you please, Jane.
Your appetite certainly speaks well for my cooking, Cecil.
This out-of-doors air does make food taste good.
Out-of-doors air. Indeed, Philander, although I know that you are a well-educated man, I am sometimes perfectly aghast at your phraseology.
Mr. Philander probably means that living in the open gives one an appetite, Daddy.
Exactly, Jane. Then he should choose his mediums of expression with more meticulous scholasticism.
Well, you understood me, Professor.
But that's not the point. Not the point at all. In thought communication, whether by vocal or manual signs, is precise interpretation.
More bacon, Daddy.
Thank you. Thank you, my lover. I believe I will take some more bacon.
Cecil, what are you worrying about? You seem so thoughtful. What are you thinking about?
Well, to be frank with you, I've been wondering about my uncle, John Clayton, Lord Grinsford.
Yes, Cecil, I've been wondering.
One cannot but help to speculate. Our finding Lord and Lady Greystoke's diary here. Bless my soul, how stupid of me. Why did I not think of this before?
Go ahead, then, Professor, go ahead.
What was that you said, Philander?
I didn't say anything. You did. You said you'd thought of something.
Ah, yes. Tell me, Clayton. You think Greystoke's diary was kept up to the time of his demise?
Presumably so. Of course, one cannot be sure.
Naturally. Well, I thought there might be some entry that might disclose our approximate longitude and latitude.
Well, if there only were. But I've already looked very closely.
I'm sorry, Professor. Poor Greystoke seems to have had no more idea of his whereabouts than do we.
Surely Greystoke knew where he was going.
And so did we, Daddy. But that doesn't help us now.
True. But I would have thought that from the last reading of the sun taken by the ship's officers would...
Don't forget, Daddy, that their crew mutinied just as ours did, and that possibly, to the last, there were no readings.
Yes, most regrettable. Most regrettable.
If only I had devoted some of my time to the study of navigation, or even astronomical mathematics. So much of my leisure time could have been diverted to other subjects.
On the off chance that you might at some future time be shipwrecked, or marooned, or cast upon a desert shore? That Philander, such self-condemnation displays a very fine spirit, but somewhat unnecessary morbidness.
Incidentally, Daddy, now seems as good a time as any to ask for an explanation.
Yes, my dear, yes. Explanation of what?
Why, you told me we were going on an archaeological excavating survey, when in truth you were on a hunt for buried treasure.
Ah, well, that, my dear, is a somewhat lengthy... And don't forget, Jane, had you not thrown the map of the treasure overboard, we should know where we are because the latitude and longitude were marked on that map.
Really? Oh, that's a very brilliant defense, Professor. But with one flaw. If Jane had not thrown the map overboard, we would not be anywhere. Except at the bottom of the sea.
Quite right, Clayton. Jane saved our lives. And you, Professor Archimedes Q. Porter, I'm surprised at you. Defending yourself by means of legal trickery. That of bringing an irrelevant accusation.
The result, Jane, would have been the same. The finding of the treasure would have financed the archaeological survey.
Sort of the house that Jack built idea. Well, personally, I'd be very much surprised if there is such a treasure.
Now, Jane, you must not talk in such derogatory terms of my very good friend, the name escapes me for the moment. Yes, a bookseller in Philadelphia.
You mean the stamp collector in Baltimore?
Yes, of course. But anyway, he's a very good friend, I assure you. Otherwise, he would never have trusted me with the map.
But you paid $1,000 for that map, Daddy.
Jane, you grieve me deeply. Such a paucity of confidence in your father. Why don't you say something, Philander?
From internal evidence, I am convinced now, really.
Oh, no, Mr. Philander. That's Dad's speech. By the way, our supply of canned meat is getting awfully low.
Well, suppose I take a rifle and do a little shooting, what?
Yes, Clayton, yes. Perhaps some nice, juicy capons. Ah, delightful.
Well, I was hardly thinking of capon, but I thought perhaps some boar or, to venture, a young deer.
Shall I go along, Clayton? As beater, I believe it's called. Don't you hunters always have one?
Well, frightfully decent of you and all that, but I fancy not. You understand, scare the game, that sort of thing, you know.
That's true, I might. Very well, then. I shall remain here. And, well, what shall I do?
You can wash the dishes, Mr. Philander.
Yes, and there's a bit of the back wall that needs chinking. I found a deposit of clay that will do the trick. It's down by the stream. Come along, if you like, and I'll show it to you on the way.
All right. Delighted.
Well,
be careful, Cecil. I think this rifle is all... Yes, it's fine. Well, cheerio. I'll be right back.
Down at the waterhole, Tarzan lies flat on the muddy edge, face in the water, sucking up in great draughts his morning drink. Majestically, his friend Tantor, the elephant, stands beside him, alternately drinking and spraying the cool water over his gray hide with his sinuous trunk. Tarzan splashes the clear water over his lithe form and then springs erect and, skirting the edge of the pool, strides to the forest fringe. Springing upward and swinging his way through the trees, he leisurely makes his way along the ape trail that leads to the beach and his hut. He stops. What was that? No beast of the jungle makes such a noise when breaking cover. That breaking of twigs, that trampling of leaves is made by a... M-A-N. Quickly, Tarzan thrusts aside the screening leaves. He looks down a shimmering, dancing shaft of sunlight cutting its way between two giant trees, and there in the cleared space at the crossing of the trails stands Clayton. The stick that makes the big noise, his rifle, is at the ready as he peers intently at Horta the boar, half hidden in the gloom of the matted undergrowth. Clayton raises the rifle. The shot plows through the infuriated brute's shoulder as it charges. Clayton pulls back the rifle bolt. The ejector jams. The empty shell hangs in the breach. The Englishman grips the rifle by the barrel. He swings, hits Horta in the flank. Eyes are gleam, head lowered, dripping, tusks bared. Again, Horta charges. Clayton catches his foot in a trailing vine. He stumbles. The boar, its bloodshot eyes staring straight ahead, misses the fallen man. It digs its hoof into the moss. Like lightning, it turns, but before it can charge, Tarzan, knife in hand, drops on the brute's leathery back. Up and down the bronze arm flashes, and it's over. Horta the boar is dead.
Thank you. My rifle jammed. Once again, I owe you my life.
Farmagani, Avon Bundle, Horta!
Tarzan points to the bullet hole in Horta's shoulder. Clayton shakes his head. Sorry, old man. I don't understand. We were running short of meat. Boar. Eat.
Clayton points to the carcass and then to his mouth. Tarzan understands. He nods his head, bends down, and with never an effort, hoists the dead boar to his shoulder and takes to the trees, followed by the indignant chatter of disturbed and scolding monkeys as he carries his burden through the high branches toward the hut.